here. What's up, Giants fans, Hub watchers, YouTube and Rumble subscribers, Twitter and Instagram followers? It is Kush back at it again with another New York Giants update video. Now, of course, as the title says, today we are going to be talking about the New York Giants injuries and a little bit of update that we got on them. A lot of it is from yesterday, keep in mind, so we're still waiting on a little bit of new information. I did manage to find a Yahoo article that was from this morning at 8:30 a.m. approximately, and then of course talk a little bit about Kadarius Toney and his ejection and stuff like that. So of course the Giants have about 11 injuries currently on their team from week one to now, and all of those guys were starters. We could count them off. I did it in my reaction video, but I'll do it one more time for here. And I actually forgot one of those dudes in Jabril Peppers, which is what makes it 11. But if we go in the order that it happened, you got Shane Lemieux, Nick Gates. After those two, I want to say the next person injured was Sterling Shepard, Darius Slayton. Then you got Blake Martinez, Jabril Peppers, Andrew Thomas. Then it was the stuff that happened during the game. That was Saquon Barkley, Daniel Jones. Why am I forgetting his name? Kenny Galladay. The reason I'm forgetting his name is because barely makes any impact on the field right now. I already said Jabril Peppers. Rodarius Williams. Yep. And Rodarius Williams was indeed a starter for us. Make no mistake. He started a lot of games for the Giants. So that's 11 players right there just gone. And the team is 1-4. Of course the team is 1-4 when you got 11 players injured, among other reasons. But among those 11 guys, we could count out the players that were already ruled out for the year, right? Which was a good amount of them. So Shane Lemieux, Nick Gates, they were ruled out for the year. Blake Martinez was ruled out for a year with the torn ACL. And is that it? I think everybody else is slated to return. You know, Slayton and Shepard, they have hamstring injuries, so it's going to be tricky to say when their return is. Andrew Thomas was already in uniform. He was active, so he's going to return soon. Saquon, it didn't look like anything too serious, at least in my opinion, because of the swelling. I think he's going to be fine. And of course, we're going to read into it here. DJ, he's going to be fine. Yeah, I think the only guys that are really out for the season would have been those three that I listed. But before we do a little bit more speculation, let me get into this Yahoo article by Ralph Vacchiano. I'm pretty sure he's of SNY Sports as well, isn't he? I could be wrong about that, but shout out to Ralph for doing all this reporting for us. This is what it says on the players. There was certainly a fear given the ugly visuals when Barkley stepped on the foot of Cowboys cornerback Jordan Lewis after the end of a play late in the first quarter. Barkley's ankle bent in a disturbing and awkward way. Then the Fox cameras caught a shot of his ankle with his shoe and sock off, and it looked like it had swollen to the size of a baseball. But if it's just a low ankle sprain, which is what the NFL Network reported, he might only have to miss one game. A high ankle sprain, which is the more serious of the two, is what costed him 3 games back in 2019. And remember, it should have costed him like 6. So there you have it. It looks like it's going to be a low ankle sprain for Saquon. They're saying this article 1 week out. I just want him to miss like 2 or 3. Not because I want to see less Saquon Barkley, but because I want him to be careful. You know, he's still recovering, or you know, he just finished recovering, whatever you want to label it, from his ACL tear, from his meniscus tear and all that stuff in 2020, and now he has a low ankle sprain to go along with it. Let him take his time back. We're not really in a position to be competing for anything right now, so I'd say take your time with him. Let him go for like 2 games and then bring him back. Same thing with Daniel Jones, who I think most people, that after they saw the play, that they realize he's going to have to enter concussion protocol, and that's exactly what the article says. He suffered a concussion late in the first half when he lowered his head and absorbed a helmet-to-helmet collision with Cowboys linebacker Jabril Cox. Jones looked woozy and had to be held up by an official and then a Giants trainer before he was helped to the cart and driven to the locker room. A team source says he was doing better after the game, but there's just no way to tell how quickly he will recover. He's now in the NFL's concussion protocol, and there are steps that have to be followed before he even returns to practice. Even in the best case scenario, he won't be cleared to practice until late in the week. There's definitely time to clear him, to clear the protocol so he can play next Sunday against the Rams, but not much. If he's okay, it'll be close. Once again, listen, the team is not doing good right now. Let's call it as it is. We're 3 games behind first place in the division. Let us just take care of our players' health, man. You know what I'm saying? Especially your franchise quarterback right here. Do not want to mess around with concussions. You don't want to mess around with any injuries, to be honest. But we've seen how concussions could ruin all athletes of all different sports' lives. We already have a player on the team that deals with concussions almost on a yearly barely basis in Sterling Shepard, and at one point he has to consider retirement because of it. Do not play around with this man. Give him as much time as he needs. I've seen player return from concussion protocols like 1 week after the actual concussion. And you know what? Fine. If DJ is truly, truly healthy, I can't say anything to it. You know what I'm saying? I'm just a fan. But team doctors, man, I hope they give this dude like 2 weeks or something. I don't want him to return right away. Then Kenny Galladay, which an injury I did not see him because of my frustration yesterday. I kind of took it out on him in the unfairly in the reaction video, I admit. This is what they say. He hyperextended his knee when he collided with the cornerback Trevon Diggs, and he tried to play through it as long as he could, but it was bothering him too much, so he didn't come out the locker room after halftime. It was a good sign that he spoke to the media after the game, and his status won't be clear until he goes through an MRI today. So we'll find out probably tomorrow. Maybe we're lucky if we find out late in the afternoon. Tony, I was scared for Kadarius and, for a minute during the game because after one of his big catches, I think after the big catch Glennon gave him on the sideline, he basically went to the sideline. He was having his ankle taped up, if I remember correctly. So Tony was spotted being carted to the x-ray room after the game to have his right ankle and foot checked out after the defender landed on it while he was making a catch along the sidelines late in the game. He came back and continued his monster game where he had 10 catches, 189 yards. By the way, guys, broke, I think, the rookie record for most receiving yards in a game held by previous Giants receiver Odell Beckham, which was 185. So imagine if Tony didn't get ejected, man, he probably is getting to 200 or something. Dude's a playmaker. Dude's an absolute G. And then you got Andrew Thomas, who was active, didn't play because of the foot injury. It was bothering him during practice, and he was spotted with a bad limp every day he was out there. He worked out before the game, but the results weren't good, and Judge said he was only available in case of emergency. They seem to have hoped he'll be ready for next Sunday, but they won't know until they see him practice on Wednesday. And as for the other guys on this list, Sterling Shepard, Darius Slayton, is what I said earlier. There's no real timetable because hamstrings are, you know, tricky and different for every player. And then for Jabril Peppers, he's also on a hamstring injury as well. So same issue as Sterling Shepard and Darius Slayton. But for the other guys, it's looking like it might be 2 to 3 weeks, in my opinion, for Saquon, Daniel. Kenny Galladay, I have no idea what a hyperextended knee is like, and he's been banged up really essentially since he signed with us, so there's no telling how healthy he could be and how fast he could get healthy for us. Andrew Thomas, I think he'll be back, if not next week, then by Carolina game. So once again, 2 to 3 weeks, we're looking at Carolina or Chiefs for the return of most of these players. At least that's what I hope, because once again, I want to take my time with them. I want them to be safe. You know what I'm saying? Player safety is my concern as of right now. And since now we're finished with that, shifting into the Kadarius Toney thing, I just want to say this before we talk about it. I really hope Joe Judge doesn't do what he did with Andrew Thomas last year, and that's make an example, quote unquote, of Kadarius Toney for throwing the punch at the Cowboys player during the game. We all remember last year, Andrew Thomas, I think he was late to a team meeting or something like that, and then he didn't get that much snaps during the Cowboys game, which was, I don't know. At the time, I wasn't sure how I feel about it. Now, I'm still not sure how I feel about it. If this man sits Kadarius Toney or makes him miss significant snaps because of his, his punch during the Cowboys game, then I'm going to disagree with the decision, because Toney is currently the best player on the team, without a doubt. He's currently the only reason we're being kept in games, we're scoring points, and we're moving up and down the field, okay? So please keep him in there, man. He's already being punished for his action, which is wrong. You know, he never should have thrown the punch, but he is going to be fined. And there's a potential of maybe even a suspension, which I think will be a bit overboard. But Toney is getting his due in terms of punishment. All right, Judge, do not hold back this man's snaps. Toney did issue an apology via Twitter this morning as well. This is what it says. I want to take time out to apologize to the entire organization, owners, my teammates, and the entire Big Blue. Your emotions just can get the best of you sometimes. No excuses, just actions. Thank y'all. Hey, man, listen. I don't blame him either, all right? He was getting checked the entire game, roughed up by Cowboys secondary the entire game, and he finally broke, okay? I mean, dude finally broke. I'm not necessarily defending him throwing the punch, but I don't blame him, so to speak. And according to Ian Rappaport, once again, he will be evaluated for a likely fine, but no suspension. So thank God, we can't really afford for him to be suspended, but ultimately it comes back down to if Joe Judge wants to put on an additional punishment by limiting his snaps against the Rams. We'll see how it is, man. But I love this dude. Love that he's proven the haters wrong. He looks like he's going to be a great weapon for us for years to come. And really looks like he's going to be a number one guy for us in the future. So yeah, that's it for now, guys. Put your thoughts down below. Let me know what you think. Like, share, subscribe, and I'm out. Thanks for watching. Don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, and share. I'll catch y'all in the next one.